you. It's really lovely to be here, and especially thank you to Vivian for your very kind words and for being so instrumental in getting me here. Thank you. I'm going to start with a poem called Eurofighter Typhoon. My daughters are playing outside with plastic hoops. The elder is trying to hula over and over, but it falls off her hips, too heavily freighted with beads. It's over-accessorized junk, but she keeps trying, and the younger is watching and giggling, and they're happy in the bright afternoon. I'm indoors at the hob with the door open so I can see them, because the elder might trip and the younger is still a baby and liable to eat dirt. When out of clear skies a jet comes in low over the village. At the first muted roar, the elder runs in squealing, then stops in the kitchen, her eyes adjusting to the dimness, looking foolish and unsure. I drop the spoon and bag of peas and leave her frightened and tittering, wiping my hands on my jeans, trying to walk and not run because I don't want to scare the baby who's still sat on the patio alone, looking for her sister, bewildered, trying to figure why she's gone. All this in the odd, dead pause of the lag. Then sound catches up with the plane, and now it's grey bellies right over our house with a metallic, grinding scream, like the sky's being chainsawed open, and the baby's face drops to a square of pure fear. She tips forward and flattens her body on the ground and presses her face into the concrete slab. I scoop her up and she presses in, shuddering, screaming her strange, pelt pain cry. And it's all right now, I tell her again and again, but it's never all right now. Christ have mercy, my daughter in my arms can't steady me. Always some woman is running to catch up her children. We dig them out of the rubble in parts like plaster dolls. Mary, Mother of God, have mercy. Mercy on us all. There's a series of poems in Bright Travellers that take the paintings, I nearly said the poems of Vincent van Gogh, the paintings of Vincent van Gogh as their step-off points. And this is the first one in the series, Yellow Room at Arles. I was back in your yellow room at Arles, an ochre cube with a bed like a crib and your paintings all over the walls. But that's not it. I wanted to tell you that it's so much worse, that the times of clarity and grace are more and more remote, that I'm losing ground to the dark. So I've dug my way back to your golden room, your wounded girl, your damned and lovely prostitute, come to sleep it out, teepeed in your scarlet blanket, with the lamplight dimmed to a red bordello warmth and a chair against the door. We'll talk or fuck or sit and flip cards. Whatever you want, just ferry me through unharmed, uncut. This is Portrait with a Bandaged Ear. You show up at my door, weeping, exhausted, a rag tied under your chin like a corpse, mumbling, Cherie, Cherie. I draw you a bath, soak your dirty underclothes, heat soup. You sit by the fire in my mother's old housecoat and doze. When you wake, you've turned. You tell me I stink. open every window to the wind, throw water all over the bed as if our old love burned, shout whore, whore, whore as you leave. You show up at my door, drunk but lucid. Your right ear heals to pearly pink buds, the naked hole in your head flecked with wax. You eat stew right out of the pan and keep me informed. Mannequins talk filth. They are hungry and bored. They would like to be saved. Birds ventriloquize the damned, sins that make you muffle your head and shake. You say you'd like to be well. You shove bread in your pockets for later and walk back into the cold. You show up at my door. The veins stand out on your temples. Your nose is pinched and thin. Angels have voices that spin and shine and must be listened to side on. These window box geraniums, for instance, spilling crimson petals on the road, are a counsel for bloodletting, leeches. You'll interpret their signs for the world. Oh, you choose them over me, then come stumbling home, three toes lost of frostbite, a crust of blood on your upper lip, and I let you in, and I let you in, and I let you in. Remember the long afternoons of our youth, spent wrapped in the covers, as if night would never come. How fierce you were, and clear back then. Now I find you stirring in the chamber pot for signs, or stood in the kitchen, your bare blue limbs shining, looking for knives. Cherie, Cherie, we're running out of grace. Men will come and ask me to confirm your name. I want you strong and well. Please stay. I'm going to read some cheery poems at the end. This one, not so much. This is about a miscarriage. Sheep. She's lying under a low wind, bedded in mud and afterbirth, her three dead lambs knotted in a plastic bag. Crows have pecked out her arse, and now the hen that's been circling all morning tugs at a string of birth meat like she's pulling a worm in the yard. I can't not watch. I too lay stunned in my own dirt, the miscarried child guttering out, soaking the mattress in blood. I was afraid to look down for what I might see, a human face, a fist. Yet once it was done, I got up, gathered my bedding and walked. And I'll finish with daughter song for Isla. Once all this is done, soaping you in the bath, your half songs and wet arms, and the owl in the woods behind the house, and the scream of a vole caught up, soaring through the boundless dark. And once all this is gone, the sea crept in from the dazzling bay, its mouth even now at the red cliff. Once it's travelled in, and these high meadows are underwater entirely. The vetch rotted back, and the warrens flooded sumps, and the fox runs trampled by the current, and the fox herself long drowned. Still, my love for you will ride, ride on. Like that star in the old songs, its long-journeyed light helpless and absolute. Yes, though it makes no sense, and I speak for your father also in this, our love is like that. It hurtles on and on, and you are its lodestone, and you are the ground it falls upon. Thank you very much for listening.